It is indeed. Good morning.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. I love that you introduce yourselves and write comments in the chat. Please keep saying hello. It's awesome to see who's here and to be able to wish each other a good morning. Can you lie? Okay, we'll just give it another minute. I see there are plenty of folks just entering. Please put in the chat a good morning to everyone if you like. You can say where you're calling in from or zooming in from. It's awesome to see everyone's hellos. Okay. Welcome, everyone, and a good morning to you. Welcome to day two of our 24th annual Making Healthful Decisions Conference and our second virtual version of this event. Welcome back to you if you attended yesterday's sessions, and a warm welcome if you can join us today. My name is Julika von Stackelberg. I am with Cornell Cooperative Extension in Orange County, New York. And as one of the organizers of this event, I am really pleased to be here with you all and thank you so much for coming. As we begin today, I want to give a special thank you to the team of organizers who have helped to put this conference together. Some of them have been with us since the inception of this event. And so the thanks go to Dr. Andrew Bell with Westchester Department of Children's Mental Health, Annie Colonna with the Warwick Valley Community Center, Whitney Force with Garnet Health, Amanda Langzetter with Sullivan 180, Susie McCormick with Cornell Cooperative Extension, Moira Mencher with Garnet Health, Brianna Pinos Grande with MISN, Robin Rosenberg with Mount St. Mary College, Jenny Sanchez with Sullivan 180, Stephanie Suznovsky with MISN, formerly MISN and now Garnet Health, Melinda Ware with Cornell Cooperative Extension in Sullivan County, and Grace Welly with MISN. Their support, their flexibility, their patience, and their ideas is what got us here today. So thank you all so much. I'd like to walk you briefly through what to expect during the next few hours on this day. We will begin with our day with a dynamic panel discussion that will be followed by a Q&A. You can submit your questions through the Q&A feature on your screen, and you can chat in the feature during the conversation. But the questions for the Q&A, please submit those through the Q&A feature that you can see at the bottom of your screen. This session will end at 12 p.m., giving you a chance to have a lunch or tend to what you need to do. We'll then return for the 5 workshops this afternoon simultaneously at 1 p.m. And you should have received the link for whichever workshop you registered for. And if you need any assistance, we'll be available during that break time. And the best way to contact us is via email, and I will also, we'll put this the email in the chat shortly. So a very big thank you also goes to our lead sponsor, Garnet Health Medical Center, an important partner in our community when it comes to healthcare, as well as to the Orange County Youth Bureau, the United Way, and the Child Care Council of Orange County. Today's panel will address youth mental health, wellness, and growth after 2020. And this really seems to be an ever important topic of conversation, as the US Surgeon General yesterday just issued an important statement that talked about or issued a stark warning about the mental health of young people in our country. But young people are way more than their mental health. And there is a, it's a complex topic to be discussed. And there's a lot of assets that we have available. And so we are really looking forward to a wonderful conversation here with the folks who are joining us on the panel, who I will introduce to you now.
Henri Prevost will be joining us remotely from Claremont, California, where he's studying economics and public policy at Pomona College. A 2020 graduate of Warwick Valley High School, Henri entered the youth prevention field first through his research evaluating secondhand nicotine exposure in public schools from e-cigarette use. Inspired by the work of advocates met through this project, he joined the efforts of this local prevention coalition and coordinated the Warwick Valley Prevention Coalition's Youth Academy just this summer. Looking to the future, Henri is excited to merge his academic study with prevention's most pressing issues, creating market and evidence-based solutions in today's public health landscape. Dr. Brooke Balchin is a board-certified pediatrician, childhood and adult trauma survivor, and a mother of twin 7-year-old boys. Dr. Balchin has extensive knowledge in child and adolescent development and is a strong advocate for children and families promoting health, safety, and resilience. Over the past decade, Dr. Balchin has worked in a variety of clinical settings, including private practice, community foster care, and schools. Dr. Balchin has served as the medical director for districts throughout Westchester since 2012. She's an active member of the American Academy of Pediatrics Council on School Health and Westchester County Department of Community Health Trauma Subcommittee. In June 2020, Dr. Balchin was appointed to the New York State Education Department's Reopening Schools Regional Task Force, and in May 2021 received the 2020 Distinction to New York Chapter 3 AAP Special Achievement Award for the leadership throughout the COVID pandemic. Inaudi Esposito is the executive director of the Orange County Human Rights Commission, whose primary purpose is to foster mutual respect and understanding among all groups in the county and to promote understanding of equity, acceptance, unity, and humanity. Inaudi's expertise include over 15 years working in social justice, diversity, equity, and inclusion, and gender violence issues, including intimate partner violence, sexual assault, and human trafficking. She's a sought-after speaker and has presented at numerous conferences, including in the 2019 TEDx Newburgh series, where she discussed diversity and privilege in her talk called Turning Differences into Strengths. Go check it out. Jessica Grimm knows firsthand the negative impact that can occur on young adults' development by not having an authentic voice in their own treatment, goals, and life, but not having one of her own growing up. Ms. Grimm is the executive director of Brave Hearts, MOVE Move New York, Inc., an authentically youth-led nonprofit organization where she coordinates a multitude of youth-led services and initiatives for young adults affected by mental health, juvenile justice, and child welfare systems. The Brave Hearts provide services through an authentic and innovative partnerships with the Children's Village, the official organization, mentor of youth-led agency. Jessica and the Brave Hearts also work in partnership with a multitude of county, state, and national jurisdictions, such as the Department of Corrections, Family Court, and the Department of Social Services, to provide authentic youth voice to develop responsive and healing systems and services. Mrs. Grimm has been advocating locally, nationally, and internationally to transform youth services systems to improve pathways to adulthood for youth in care or alumni in care in the intersection areas of housing, education, employment, and peer support for over a decade. Ariana Smith of Montebello, New York is a senior at Suffern High School with an interest in environmental science. She's a member of the speech and debate team, Suffern Varsity Cross Country and Track and Field, 4-H Club of Rockland County, and the American Red Cross Club. Ariana is also one of two designated role models for Suffern High School. Upon graduation, Ariana plans to study environmental science and aspires to further her education by attending law school for a degree in environmental law. In the summer of 2021, Ariana completed an internship with the Lamont Doherty Earth Next Generation of Hudson River Educator STEM program for underrepresented groups. Through this experience, she was able to conduct research on the inhabitants of the Hudson River and educate the community about the Hudson River and effects of the climate change. Her life goal is to advocate for climate change education. In addition, Ariana recently served as a team lead with the Youth for Climate Justice team at the Cornell Cooperative 4-H Club and organized a river cleanup. This experience affirmed there is an interconnectivity of small organizations with combined resources that can educate people on climate change from a unique perspective. Additionally, Ariana is an avid writer and has been awarded the Scholastic Writing Award on more than one occasion, and her work has been published in Scrawl. Last but not least, she's very excited to join this panel and have this experience. And with that, I am delighted to welcome our panelists.
Thank you so much. And I believe that the slideshow skipped call. And so let me see that I can go back very quickly and reverse that.
Jessica Green knows firsthand.
Okay, so it appears there's a technical glitch. And because I don't have your bio right in front of me to read to everybody, Carl, would you give us a very quick introduction before we hand it over to everyone? Because we would love to hear a little bit about your background before we can move on. You're on mute. You're unmuted. Yes.
One of my business cards says I co-chair the Westchester County Continuum Care for the Homeless. Another one says I run my own consulting company, but the one that really matters says I'm a village dreamer, community organizer, and grant writer. And so over 30 something years, I've raised $560 million, written over 2,000 grants, and created hundreds of programs in housing, healthcare, crime prevention, youth services, anything that helps the poor. So I get to wake up in the morning and try to figure out how to change the world, persuade someone to do it, and then find the money so they can keep doing it. Best job in the world. And I co-chair the Yonkers Coalition for Youth. The end.
Wonderful. And as you can see, this is why we want to hear about your background and make sure that doesn't skip over. And Carl also has a great co-presenter who periodically shows up walking over in front of the screen, as we can see, a beautiful cat. So welcome to you all. This is an important topic. And Henri, thank you so much. We will hand it over to you now.
Thank you so much, Yulika, and good morning to everybody. I saw some familiar names in the chat, and I'm so excited that you all could join us this morning. I'm really excited for this productive discussion we're going to have. And with that in mind, I want to dive into the questions right away and be able to give our panelists as much time to discuss their work and answer these critical questions that we've developed addressing addressing youth mental health, particularly after 2020. So with that in mind, I was hoping that we could just go around. I'll give each panelist about 2 minutes and just tell us a little bit about your work and engagement with young people, their mental health, their well-being, and particularly their growth over the past 2 years, their growth since 2020, in spite of 2020 and moving on from 2020. And if we could start with Dr. Balchen, please.
Hi, thank you, Henry, and thanks, Yulika, for having us here. So I'm a pediatrician in Westchester County. My hometown is New Rochelle, where we were the epicenter. I have two young children in the school system, and so I can't really keep track of what happened in that first year from March till December of 2020. I don't think I left my seat and my administrative work. I actually feel like, you know, thank God for SpongeBob because he did a good job babysitting my guys. And so since then, you know, I've really kind of put a strong focus back on my family and building the nurturing and wellness that we need to thrive. So, you know, I don't want to spend too much time with a more elaborate introduction, but a lot of it, you know, Maslow's hierarchy of needs is just providing safety and security. And so that was my main focus of 2020. And it was a really difficult time, challenging at a national level and a local level, working against politics to provide that safety and security that we all needed as a physician, as a parent, as a community member. How can we re-engage? How can we bring our communities back together and really empowering the nurses that I worked with, their direct outreach to families to support them, and my connections through the school systems and others to try to put into place protocols that would provide the safest environment. We're not going to eliminate all risk, but to provide minimal risk to a larger community as we try to bring everybody back to school and re-engage.
Thank you so much. Carl, could you provide a little bit of an introduction again as well, just with a focus on your work in the last 2 years?
I never follow instructions, and being this old, I take the long view. So it strikes me that if you saw someone drowning, the natural impulse would be to jump in the river and pull them out. And if when you got back to shore, you heard another scream from the water, you'd probably do it again and then again and again. But eventually, you would know that you need to go upstream and try to figure out how to keep people from falling in the river. So 38 years ago, when I was a social work student, I organized Yonkers' first shelter for homeless adults. And it was just going to be temporary, except the need didn't go away, so it turned permanent. But then there were so many problems with DSS, we turned into welfare advocates, and there were so many mental health issues, we started a mental health clinic. But there were so many substance abuse, we started a substance abuse clinic. But then we were burying a substance abuser every week from HIV/AIDS, so we started $1 million of new HIV services. And then there were other health issues like diabetes and asthma, but it wasn't just singles, it was families too. And they needed housing, so we built it, but they couldn't afford it, so we started job training. And then with the job training, there were educational deficits, so we started adult remediation. And I wound up going upstream till I was working with Yonkers, Mount Vernon, and Rochester to try to make sure that elementary school kids went to school regularly and got a solid foundation in reading and math. And I thought, now I'm at the headwaters, until Andy Bell and I talked. And the common theme from all of that was people trying to overcome the impacts of the traumas they'd experienced in their life and try to have enough resilience to believe the change was possible. And that, I think, is really the headwaters of everything we do. And that's why I'm glad to be here with you today.
Thank you so much. And Audi?
Hi, good morning, everyone. And thank you so much for Cornell for putting this together. Thank you, Henry, for hosting and facilitating this conversation. And hello to all of my fellow panelists. I am Inaudi Esposito, as was introduced, the Executive Director for the Orange County Human Rights Commission. And in my role, I really have the privilege to work with folks from all sorts of background, including schools. And my role in, you know, supporting youth these last 2 years have been multiple fold, right? As Dr. Balchen shared, I am also a mother. mother of three, and not only have I had to put a lot of focus on, you know, making sure that my children were doing okay and focusing on how do I support their mental health growth and their mental health stabilization and just supporting them, but also how do I build community around me and around them? That includes my neighbor's kids, right? That includes all six of the kids, you know, the neighborhood kids that come over, and how do we support each other and making sure that, you know, the saying, it takes a village, it really does take a village. On the professional front, I've done a lot of work with schools, specifically teachers and administration, on having really difficult conversations around how can we support our young people. Specifically in my work after the George Floyd, the murder of George Floyd, the Black Lives Matter movement last year, there's been a lot of focus on social justice issues in the schools and students wanting to use their voice and being empowered and saying, oh no, my voice does matter. I will stand up and talk about these issues. So I've had the honor to work with a lot of educators around supporting students and making sure that they understand that although, you know, this pandemic, you know, we're all on the same boat, right? But it's still impacting all of us differently. You know, whether it's communities of color, whether it's, you know, folks from oppressed communities or with less socioeconomic access to different resources, we may be on the same boat, but we are definitely not impacted the same. So I've had the honor to work with different young people and educators around supporting them during that process.
Thank you so much. We're so grateful to have your perspective and your voice in this conversation. Jessica, I'll turn it to you.
Hi, good morning, everyone. And thank you so much for having me here today. As previously mentioned, I'm Jessica Grimm, Director of Braveheart Services at the Children's Village and also at Bravehearts Move New York, Inc. It would be impossible to summarize in appropriate words the past 2 years in 2 minutes. So I'm not going to attempt to do that. I'm actually looking forward to further delving into the complexities of this question and this subject matter throughout our presentation today. But really, if I can summarize, I wanted to just really piggyback off of Dr. Balkin's reference of Maslow's hierarchy and bring up a sense of belonging and how that aspect has impacted our young people, specifically our systemically impacted young people who were in institutions and congregate care settings and away from their communities and families during the pandemic were hit tremendously hard during this pandemic. We already knew that there was disproportionality within our systems. We already knew that marginalized youth were not being given access to voice and choice within their lives and their services, and severe isolation, social separation, and honestly, the lack of communication and continuity of care throughout the pandemic has not just had a start and finish closing up period. It is ongoing. There are significant traumas that young people have faced that we are Bravehearts that we work with day in and day out that even got them to the doors of accessing a system have been amplified due to this pandemic. And we're seeing it now in our communities, whether it's through gun violence, whether it is through heightened mental health and lack of access to therapeutic supports and services, and just all around fear and anxiety. I mean, I think for every human being, we have gone through this experience together. While we have all interpreted it differently, this pain that we have experienced has been something that has brought us together. And now the question really remains is how do we heal this pain? And how do we put the supports and services in place in order to make sure that young people can get through this while remaining heard, while remaining given access to the things that they need, and also just making sure that we're doing the best job that we can to take care of ourselves because of some of the experiences that we have faced as my co-panelists have mentioned, we all have families at home that we were dealing with medical challenges, loss of employment, questions and concerns around vaccinations, all of these very difficult conversations that we were having, we were leveraging at home, and then also having the ability to take care of ourselves in real time to be able to discuss these things with young people. And there has been a historical construct when it comes to access of information and how young people are able to receive that information and get access to their very own information. And when you create a pause to life itself, it only further exacerbated that issue. So I think our past 2 years, we have just been trying desperately to not keep continuity of care and service, keep access to information. When am I going home? When do I go to court next? When do I get to see my therapist in person again? And also continue to build and instill this sense of belonging for young people.
Thank you so much, Jessica. Let's wrap it up with Ariana.
Hi, thank you all for having me. So my name is Ariana Smith, and I am a senior at Suffern High School. I'm very passionate about the environment and educating the general public about climate change. So during the summer, I had the opportunity to intern with the Lamont and Doherty Earth Observatory with the next generation of Hudson River educators at Emmeline Park at Havasstra Bay. And there we were able to do research on the Hudson River. So I worked in a group with other teenagers like myself, and we all learned about the Hudson River with hands-on experience. We did water and soil chemistry, we caught a lot of fish, and we tested various areas around the park for lead. Our work on field days brought many curious people, and they would often ask us about the work that we were doing, and oftentimes they would even join us in our research. So I feel that the work that we did helped engage the Havasstra community with the environment and the Hudson River, something that many of the people living in that community weren't very familiar with. So especially during the troubling times during the pandemic, I felt that it was very important to keep in contact with the community in a COVID-safe way, of course, as with all the social distancing and quarantine, many of us could feel a little bit lonely. So through my internship, I was able to meet new people and learn new things, all while doing what I love, which is helping the environment. So this experience gave me the opportunity to connect and engage with the public and teach them about the environment. And I feel that this experience helped us all stay grounded and connected through science and nature. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Ariana. And thank you so much to all of our panelists for just introducing yourselves and framing our conversation in the context of this past year that we've all been through together. So as we speak a little bit more broadly on these issues of youth mental health, I want to pivot our conversation and just bring up a recent fact about how the American Academy of Pediatrics, the Children's Hospital Association, and the American Academy of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry recently declared an unprecedented national emergency of children's mental health. So I want to begin with that in mind by asking Dr. Balkin if you could give us some insight into just how urgent this crisis that's facing our nation is, how our young and how it's affecting our community's young people, particularly in our own communities, and what makes this period of time so unique for young people, and why is this crisis just taking hold now? Besides the obvious, you know, pandemic that we've all been through, Dr. Balkin, I'll give it to you.
Great questions, and it's Balchan, just for correction and pronunciation. I'm going to share my screen. Give me a second here. All right, so I'm going to start off by just letting you know, I had to update this slide. I had originally put on a quote from Dr. Beers, who is the current and outgoing president of the American Academy of Pediatrics, but a statement came from the Surgeon General yesterday in the new advisory, in which he's saying that he believes coming out of the COVID pandemic, we have an unprecedented opportunity as a country to rebuild in a way that refocuses our identity and common values, puts people first, and strengthens our connections to each other. Dr. Murthy said in the advisory, if we seize this moment, step up for our children and their families in the moment of need, and lead with inclusion, kindness, and respect, we can lay the foundation for a healthier, more resilient, and more fulfilled nation. And I couldn't have said it any better, but I think that just really culminates all of the feelings and all the expressions and experiences that we've had. And what's been brought up throughout this conference, the work that we're doing to have it at the national level, just summarized in this format, really gives hope. And I think we're going to be touching more on hope later on. So in his updated statistics, which may have, you know, the statistics are in flux, right? We have data that comes from periods of time. So right now, he's mentioning that 20% of children between the ages of 3 and 17 have mental, emotional, developmental, or behavioral disorders, and many are not receiving adequate treatment. Black children under the age of 13 are nearly twice as likely as to die by suicide as white children. And youths with socioeconomic disadvantages are 2 to 3 times more likely to develop mental health conditions than their peers. One third of high school students in the past since 2019 have reported feelings of sadness or hopelessness, which is up 40% from the decade prior. And according to his advisory, and those who are seriously considering suicide or creating a suicide plan increase about 40%. So in October, those three organizations, the AAP, the American Academy of Child and Adolescent Psychiatry, and Children's Hospital Association, really put out a call to action for Congress and the Biden administration to prioritize children's mental health. They created a website called Sound the Alarm for Kids. So I encourage you to go there. There's public service messaging there that's part of this campaign, really to address the impacts of COVID, highlight this escalating crisis among children and youth that we know did not just start right now, and to provide funding, ongoing funding for existing programs and funding for new programs that had to be created throughout this time. So how urgent is this crisis facing our nation and our community's young people? Well, as we know, there's a pre-existing mental health crisis in our country, and that met a global pandemic that has not been seen in 100 years. So when we have 1 in 5 kids experiencing mental health conditions, and we have children experiencing serious emotional and behavioral difficulties and rising rates of suicide, which is the second leading cause of death for our youth, we started out pretty bad. Then we have COVID, right? So when COVID hit, it didn't affect a fraction of our students or our children in our communities or just some of our families. It affected all of us in some way. In the spring of 2020, at the peak of school closures, 55 million kids in 124,000 public and private schools across the country had closures, right? When we reopened in the fall, only half of districts reopened, and the other half had a combination of remote or full hybrid instruction. So there was disruptions and an interruption of vital services and supports. And we know that those supports that are put in place were with the lack of them, they were disproportionately impacting populations of color, historically under-resourced communities, families living in poverty, refugee or asylum seekers, children with special health care needs, those in the child welfare and juvenile justice system, and the LGBTQ community. Furthermore, those communities were also experiencing a disproportionate number of deaths. And so with that, tremendous amount of grief. And then there was a lot of misinformation and myths about the impact of COVID on children. For example, in the beginning of the pandemic, kids were supposedly not affected at all, but we know that the impact of COVID on our adult population directly and indirectly affects our children. Just look at the cumulative case numbers. We've had over 49 million cases of COVID in the country and 787,000 deaths. Another truth is that children, who make up 22% of the population, are now accounting for 25% of all new COVID diagnoses. And by the end of November, nearly 6.9 million children had been tested positive for COVID. Out of our pediatric community, 1 in 5 or 140,000 children lost a parent or caregiver. And nearly 6,000 have been diagnosed with multi-system inflammatory syndrome in children, which is a very complicated multi-organ system inflammatory diagnosis, putting children in the hospital or in the ICU. And it caused 52 to die. Overall, we've lost 741 kids to COVID in our country, and this is terrible. So another question that Henri asked was, why is this crisis just taking hold now? And I believe Jessica was saying, we have ongoing issues. And this is a little diagram that I created just to keep things in mind. We haven't had a stop to any of this. We're continuing to see rapidly changing and conflicting or fake news that's published depending on what your news source is. There's a 24-hour news source, including social media, and things just don't always make sense. And science is changing. So when one day the medical and scientific community say something and people take hold of it, it may change within the day or the week. And so that can cause a lot of uncertainty in the community. But we still have illness, death, quarantine, isolation, housing, food insecurities, and the technological gap. We're experiencing intimate partner violence rising and abuse of all natures, community violence, political discord, and natural disasters. With the loss of routine, celebrations, memorials, kids also are losing their developmental experiences that we know are so important for their independence over time. And this whole concept of reopening, what is the return to normal? We have to address vaccine hesitancy and the new variants, and that could be scary too. So we're balancing all this, not just for our youth, but for our families and professionals. So those that are experiencing symptoms of trauma are afraid, and this is an acronym that I took from some colleagues that published a book over the summer that I encourage you to look into, Childhood Trauma and Resilience, published by the AAP Press. But in terms of afraid, we have frets and fears, difficulty regulating. There's concerns about attachment to our caregivers or others, sleep disturbances, physical symptoms, and educational delays, especially to our children with special needs and special education that may have not received services for many, many months or didn't get to engage with their service providers in a way that was meaningful. And then overall just feeling defeated or dissociated because of the trauma of it all, PTSD and depressive type symptoms. People may experience some, all of these at any time, and it waxes and wanes and it fluxes, and just being aware can help us move forward. So the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services also published a brief in September, and this just gives a tribute to, our knowledge of ACEs and how children and families that have experienced ACEs are at higher odds of developing mental health conditions. So this just reaffirms what we already know. Same goes for the data on increasing numbers of ER visits and suicidality, particularly among girls at the beginning of the year. And I just leave you all with this very heavy data-focused, presentation with thoughts of hope as we transition to the rest of the panel today and hopefully in our summary. So thank you.
Thank you so much for your insight. And now pivoting to Carl, with hope in mind, I wanted to see if you could speak a little bit briefly about hope, give us a little bit more of a definition and define some barriers to hope that many of our community's youth experience daily in our schools and at home that we should better understand as providers. And that notwithstanding, why do you think it's so critical that our comprehensive efforts are directed towards building hope and keeping this focus on hope in our work with the young people in our communities that we serve?
I think the title of what I'd be about to say is 9 Strategies for Building Hope. And start with the first one, to realize that not all the kids believe they'll have a future. The only plans my parents made for my future had nothing to do with college, wedding, or even work. They just bought a funeral plot next to theirs. And the assumption was that my 3 sisters would have a home and a family and go on to have a life, and I was going to die young and alone. And it was my father who was sick, not me. But in the dysfunction, we all sort of got confused about who was dying, I guess. But I think that's my family's unique dysfunction. But I think for a lot of people who grow up in neighborhoods surrounded by people dying young from violence, accidents, and disease, or disappearing with incarceration, there's a feeling that I can't count on being 60, I can't count on being 40, I can't count on being 20. And one of the most striking things that any of the Bravehearts said in the early days when we were organizing it, one of the young men was like 18. And he said, I've been in the system my whole life. I've had a parade of caseworkers and counselors And no one ever asked me today what I wanted to be till when I grew up. I never thought about it today because literally no one ever thought to ask me the question. And so one of the most powerful things you can do is just like encourage youth to dream or have a vision or just to think about what if there is a future. And I think the second thing is, you know, part of why that can happen. When my youngest daughter was very young, I was putting her to bed one night and we went through the months of the year and all the happy things she could look forward to each month. And like October was trick-or-treating and November was Thanksgiving feast and the family gathers. And December is Christmas and Hanukkah and January is New Year's with your cousin in Philadelphia. And there's Passover in Florida and there's a vacation and your birthday and all kinds of things. And it gave like a happy rhythm of life where every month there was something to look forward to. And I think a lot of kids don't have that happy rhythm. And what they see instead is an endless wall of gray. And so the second thing that the people in your organizations can do is to try to help youth have celebrations, happy events to mark those times. But I think also to know about them in advance. Like, I think it's really powerful to have something you can look forward to for spring and something for summer and something for fall and something for winter, where it's not just endlessly swept in a torrent that makes you feel like you're drowning, but instead predictable things you can count on and look forward to. So happy rhythms. I think the third is like just remembering that there's light, because I think sometimes you're so surrounded by darkness, it's like you forget that life exists. Or if there's so much violence and cruelty around you, it's like that's the only tune you recognize and you're hyper attuned to it and that's all you see. So I think the third thing is like reminding young people that there is light. But you've got to be careful, because if you deny that the darkness exists, they're just going to think you're a fool because they may know more than you do about the darkness in the world and the cruelty around. And you also have to be careful to communicate that there's light for people who are like them, because it's easy to believe that life is better for rich people, white people, TV people, whatever it is. It's believing that there's actually a possibility of a better future for you. That is the crucial element in hope. A fourth thing I think is kind of highlighting moral heroes. One day on the news, there was someone doing the right thing. He was throwing away his whole army legal career to help someone in Guantanamo Bay by suing the president of the United States, going to the Supreme Court and winning. And I called the daughters in. It's like, quick, quick, quick. The news has a moral hero on. And normally it's bigots, thieves, and fools. And here is somebody you could actually like be proud of that actually see that. So I think highlighting the moral heroes in the universe. And the last five things all have to do with self-efficacy. Because even if you believe there's a future and it could be good, a lot of people feel that there's nothing they can do to shape their own future. And these five things are ways you can help that. One of the main ones, I think, is to always be careful in how you speak to and about a young person, to stress that they're not victims, but survivors. Because you could take the same set of life facts and told one way, terrible things have happened to you, you're a helpless victim and you just feel nothing but despair. And the other way is terrible things have happened to you and you must be tough as nails because you walked out the other side and it's astonishing what you've been able to stand up and walk through. And that's whole different way of feeling about the whole life ahead. And none of the facts change. It's just the narrative and the way that you present it. So that's important. I think the sixth thing is to give them to build a sense of efficacy by giving them the voices and choices that Jessica was talking about, to let them choose part of what they do, part of what they services, they get all the parts of their life that you can, where they're not just helpless recipients, but active navigators in their own life. The seventh thing I think is about creating ways where there's goals and rewards that are achievable, like a sense of I can actually dare to want something. because sometimes it's scary to want something because you'll feel like it's being snatched away. But to have the experience of wanting something, working for it, and succeeding at it and getting it in a small way, in the bigger ways, in the longer term ways, a whole succession. I think those are the kinds of experiences that help you develop a sense of hope. The eighth is, I think, coping strategies for the darkness. It's like to teach kids, here's what you do if you're being bullied, or if your teacher's being unfair, or if you don't understand the homework, or if a cop pulls you over and you've done nothing wrong. Just acknowledge that there's darkness, but you're not helpless. And the ninth, maybe the most powerful of all. Years ago, when we were working on the Bravehearts, I said that when you grow up miserable and you look back on your life, you wish you could smash your fist through the window of time and go back and rewrite the history of those you love and those and of yourself, but you can't. And the best you can do is change the life of those who are around you now. And I think that's the power of the Bravehearts. It's like you can't go back and change your parent, the parenting that you got, or the system and supports that you got, but you can change the system and supports that other people have. And there's something powerful and healing about that. It's like you, when, one more story. When I was a young kid, my mother was taking care of my older sister's baby, and he was sitting on the floor in a diaper screaming. And my mother was sitting there staring at him helpless, and I was on the other side staring at him helpless. And we both felt helpless. And I was just feeling like rage. And I think, though it's murky, I think I got beaten for crying. And it was really hard for me to have people open up and show weakness at all, because it was like a demand I couldn't meet. And then when I had my own daughters and learned how to comfort and cuddle them, it was not just them that was getting nurtured and healed. It was me as well. And so that may be the most powerful. Things like the Bravehearts may be the most powerful thing you can do to build hope in a better future. The end.
Thank you so much for your extensive answer and your great perspective. You really brought up some important ideas of trauma-informed and strength-based approaches to the services that we deliver. And with that in mind, I wanted to shift the conversation a little bit and ask Anoudi if you could speak to, the different, like how we can acknowledge the different effects of different forms of oppression, like racism, sexism, classism, ableism, and it goes on, that individuals have experienced in our long-term health and well-being, and how we can respond with a trauma-based approach, a strength-based approach, where we basically ask, like, what is strong with you instead of what is wrong with you? And what do you think that kind of approach, what kind of impact do you think that would have on our community? How would that change young people's potential in the work that we do?
Thank you so much, Henri, for that question. I love that we are all, my colleagues here are all kind of saying the same thing, but with the strength of the work that we do in mind, because it really just, we all do very similar work, right? We do it in our own little communities, we do it in our own ways, because this type of work needs to be tackled on all levels. And the first thing that actually came to mind, and I wanna just quickly share this, is the conversation around equality and equity. Can everyone see my presentation up? Great. So it's what I hear us talking about, right? I hear us talking about making sure that we are talking to young people, understanding that everyone is different and that everyone's experience has been different. And when I think about the difference between equality and equity, I like to remind folks that sure, it's all good and well, let's all be treated equally, or treat me how you want to be treated. But that's really not the best approach, because we really need to start looking at the needs of our young people based on their needs, whether it's the group that they have membership in, whether it's their individual needs, cultural needs, etc. But we need to have these conversations around, we can't just say, oh, that's a young person, or oh, it's been hard, or we're all in this pandemic and we're all impacted. No, as educators, as you know, human service providers, we understand that everyone is being impacted differently. So being able to understand that equity is really where we're going towards, and that's giving the correct amount, right? The amount of resources that an individual needs or that a community needs versus giving everyone the same amount of resources. That's a really important conversation that I wanted to have. I have three screens here, so it's hard to get my mouse to move. Let's come back here. So really in understanding the importance of first things first, it's acknowledging, right? So Henri, you talked about oppression, you talked about communities of color, you talked about ableism, you talked about, you know, and to be able to focus on strength-based and to be able to work with our young people around, you know, what's strong with you, we need to first acknowledge the challenges that they're facing, right? Which is exactly what the other panelists have talked about in really understanding. And, you know, Carl, I love the idea of, you know, acknowledging the fact that for some young people, they don't have hope. They don't think they're gonna make it because that's what they've always known, or that's what they've been told, or that's how they feel because it's what they see. And acknowledging that and its existence, I think is really powerful. I remember being a young person as an immigrant coming to this country at the age of 8, and my parents knew only what they knew, right? I only had access to the thing that they can give me. And it wasn't until middle school and then high school where I realized, oh, there's so much more out there. And not because it was given to me at home, but because I was exposed to it in school. And I know that educators know the power that they have of influence, the power that they have of helping young people, you know, not just shape their minds, but shape their futures. And I'll never forget my school counselor in high school, assuming I wasn't going to go to college because my parents didn't speak English. Who's going to help you with your, you know, college applications? No, you know, are you going to go work? And here I was, someone who was involved in 10 different clubs, every single sport you can think of, even though I was not athletic at all, but I really enjoyed staying after school. But yet not having that person, had it in other people, right? There were some of my other teachers who looked at me and said, oh, you can do this and you can do this. But I didn't know how to go and do it. And I wish someone, you know, would have acknowledged the struggles of what it's like to grow up as an immigrant. I wish I had people around me that looked like me, right? I wish I had someone who understood the experience of what it's like to grow up, translating all the teacher conferences, translating all of the documents for your parents, right? I mean, listen, my parents got lucky that I was an honest person and that I was a good kid all around, but you know, my brother, maybe not so much, because when he was doing the translating, it was all what was convenient for them, for him, I should say. But understanding that not just is it's important to acknowledge those experiencing, but going back to your question, Henri, pointing out the strengths of what that did for me as a young person, of what that has done for me as an adult, and how that really impacts how I do everything in life now, right? Because it was strengths. I knew how to advocate for myself. I knew how to advocate for my parents. I understood the struggles of, you know, being an immigrant. I understood the struggles of being in a country, in a community where you don't have a sense of community, where you don't have a sense of belonging because we don't speak the language, or because the foods aren't the foods that we're used to, or because our entire families were back home and it's just us here, where we are rebuilding something from nothing and giving young people the tools, but most importantly, just the language around, wow, that must be hard, but wow, you are strong and you are doing it. And let's talk about what you are doing. I think can just go miles and miles. And what would it do for our community? I mean, that's a given. We'd have stronger communities. We'd have, you know, people, whether it's young people, adult people, who feel like they can be their whole selves. We would have stronger, more united communities that can get through challenges, not just during emergencies, like a pandemic or like a crisis or like, we know we can get through those because our human nature kicks in and we've got each other. Now we need to focus on how can we get through the lulls of life where we can all exist within our differences, but together, right? Building community.
Thank you so much for particularly for shining a light on how we can use these strength-based approaches to really resist this oppression that's kind of systemically rooted in a lot of the systems that we work within and a lot of the populations that we deal with. And with that in mind, Jessica, I wanted to turn to you and ask if you could just share some, I guess, some implicit biases that are really the most prominent in your work and some strategies on how we can root those out from our thinking and our practice towards these youth populations. And well, I guess what are some ways that we as providers in the mental health field can better recognize the experience of these youth of oppression, you know, amidst job, housing, food insecurity, you name it, that's particularly that's been worse, made worse by the pandemic with a focus on 2020, your answer.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm just so inspired by my co-panelists right now. This is such an enriching conversation. You know, that's such a complex question that you're asking, Henri. When you think about how young people navigate and interact with professionals and with systems and services, let's just address the elephants in the room off the bat. Before the pandemic hit, there was mistrust. There was mistrust in communities when it comes to families and trusting government, trusting systems. There was mistrust when it comes to young people feeling that they have no idea what's going on about their life and decisions are being made about them without them. And that is a scary feeling. And when you talk about understanding implicit biases, you know, the first one is, you know, historically woven into our society, which is that old school notion that children should be seen and not heard. We need to really tackle power differentials and power dynamics and look at how systems and providers really share power and access of information with youth and families. Mistrust is rooted in many things, but one of them being the desperation and the need to be included. Inclusivity. And I think sometimes as professionals and providers, we are trained, we are credentialed, we are educated. So we feel that we know better than or more than. And that is not an intention that's done with malice. To the contrary, we are educated to provide a service, to provide that support. But we need to ask ourselves very humbly, are we going to be sitting at the dinner table during the holidays with these families and these young people 5, 10, 15 years from now? Do we need to be the hero in these young people's lives, or do we need to teach them how to put on their own capes and be the heroes in their own lives? The child welfare system, unfortunately, has a real challenge with infantilizing young people. I myself had to experience severe pitfalls as I transitioned out of care into adulthood because I was so accustomed to somebody coming in and saving the day when I needed to learn how to become my own hero. And leadership was not something that was I thought I would do, something I ever considered. To the contrary, I was the girl who always had her head held down. I actually still struggle with that to this day because of my past traumas. I'm over apologetic. I second guess myself. And it took adults in my life to believe in me in order for me to believe in myself. And so I bring that up only to say that everyone in this space right now is that change agent, is that person who can leave that very authentic, meaningful thumbprint on a young person or family's life to help them to take ownership over themselves. You know, oftentimes we're very quick to wag our fingers and scold a family for not accomplishing a goal or a deliverable or an expectation in a court order, but we then have to sit back and have some self-awareness and say, does this family or does this young person, have they had ample or adequate experience and opportunities to advocate for themselves? When they they speak up in a room, do we nod our heads and say yes, and then it goes nowhere? You know, what does our ability to share power, what does our ability to listen really look like? And I really appreciate Carl mentioning, I know exactly the young man he's talking about, the conversation he's talking about. He's referencing something from 8 years ago. So oftentimes the things that will solidify those restorative and healing relationships is the remembrance. It is the celebrations. It is understanding that young people, they're with us for a point in time. The systems are not families. Programs cannot substitute families. We need to take our privilege and our power, and for some of us in the room who are stakeholders, our ability to gatekeep and open or close doors, for better or worse, for youth and families, and really shift the narrative on what is possible for youth and families. The scariest thing for me as a youth advocate and an emerging young professional is the notion that I have the heart to create change. I have the passion and the gas in my gas tank to try to manifest and develop change for myself and my peers. But access to real authentic change requires power sharing. Everything that the brave hearts have been able to accomplish is, yes, due to our voices and our passion and our resilience, but also to tremendous adults in our perimeter who have allowed us space and place to be able to create our own programs, write our own budgets. And so it's just so powerful that when we sit in a collective space and we say, what more can we do? You know, you want to ask yourself, how well are you communicating? How well are you building up the ability to be emotionally relatable with young people? And if you feel like even in your position, and I'm talking to the administrators in the room who are inundated with paperwork and deliverables and demands, that is hard. So it's hard to have the weight of being expected to change the system or change communities, and also get your job done, you know, within an 8-hour work period. That's difficult. But you shouldn't feel alone. It really comes down to how you're leveraging your resources around you, our supervisory practices. When we work with young people that are institutionally impacted, the number one grievance all the time, it's said in different ways, but always has the same reoccurring thing, is problematic and inconsistent adult relationships. And the biggest challenge for us as the Bravehearts is knowing that it's not necessarily dollars that it's going to improve that. It's the dedication, the characteristics, and the capacity for compassion these adults have around our young people. And if we want to bring an equitable lens to it, we want to look at even just, and I'm speaking for congregate care impacted youth specifically with this thought, the individuals who spend the most time with young people 24/7 in congregate care settings are oftentimes paid the smallest amount within their agencies. So we talk about expecting really positive care and, you know, above and beyond compassion and change. But our staff that are coming in are dealing with the same traumas that our young people are experiencing, maybe coming from the same violence-ridden communities, dealing with the same food insecurities and challenges as our young people. And we're paying them subpar salaries. They're looking at their agencies, seen as a Black or brown staff member. I'm looking at my agency and I see all the 10 administrators for the agency are white. You know, what does my access look like for career growth and for opportunity? Can I be more than a youth care counselor and a youth care specialist? And I know that, you know, that not, it doesn't necessarily connect to young people, but the morale that a staff member has, that a social worker has, that any professional has when they check in for the day, directly impacts the behavioral barometer, if I can call it that, of a young person. because how they, if somebody said, yo, how was your day today? Do you want something to eat? Let me make you something. How are you feeling? Did you get to call your parents today? Let's set up the home visit for next week. Let's make sure you got in touch with your social worker. A staff member is going to be able to provide that narrative if they're feeling supported from their agency. So it's so important that if we're going to talk about what young people need and what young people can do to be better heard and be better validated, we need to talk about what type of supports our staff are getting, how we can be creative with our supervisory supports. So we're just boosting employee morale. And when it comes to our young people, and I don't want to be redundant, but there are just challenge after challenge after challenge that we've been experiencing collectively over the past 2 years. A couple that I just wanted to mention is the problematic challenges around telehealth. I know we're talking to a lot of mental health professionals today, so I really just wanted to lift up this notion because so many of our brave hearts have been thrusted, for better or worse, into this space of telehealth, and really struggling with the challenges around that, not social workers and clinicians not being able to read body language, not being able to know if young people are calling in from safe spaces, challenges around accessing technology and being able to even engage with telehealth, keeping up to date with psychiatric appointments, just such a significant service interruption and so much anxiety around when will I be able to see my therapist again in person? And that is just, it just weighs on top of the everyday weight that these young people are dealing with, on top of the financial hardships. You know, we have rent moratoriums that are bound to expire soon and families have apprehension and anxiety around that. The federal government was able to be supportive and provide financial assistance, unemployment services, and then those things just stop. And then we expect people to pull up their bootstraps and just get right back out there. But because of those mental health challenges and those deficits, our young people are very much struggling. And you'll see that struggle in their social media usage. And where social media is a phenomenal tool that keeps us all together, it also directly impacts young people's self-esteem and has been what we've seen in many of the communities where we're providing Braveheart programming and mentorship, an uptick of violence because a lot of these conversations manifest on social media platforms. I know myself as a mother, my oldest son is in a school district right now that is being riddled with gun violence in the community, so much so that the schools had to close last week for several days because they were trying to grapple and get a handle on this. And then you think about these layers and layers and layers, and you know, it's easy to lose hope. It's easy to, you know, get sucked into the darkness and struggle to find the light. But I think the beautiful thing about hope is that you can't know the light without the darkness. So it's really about taking our pain and turning it into purpose, really humanizing the work. I really appreciate Carl's notion about going from what's wrong with you to what's right with you. We all know about the trauma-informed work, but what about healing-centered work, where we don't have to overly victimize our young people, that they are so much more than their trauma? There is no program that I'm aware of, I think globally, that can just rid you of your traumatic experiences. Healing from trauma is a lifelong journey that manifests differently throughout your journey into adolescence and adulthood, and then into our senior years. And I really just want to close with the fact that we can all do more by just connecting more. And we're able to connect by sharing power and having those difficult conversations around race, around injustice, around equity. If we just get back to the humanness of us and just find a way to connect and love.
Thank you so much, Jessica, for your insight. That was really, really spectacular. You brought up some really interesting and important ideas about leadership and taking on personal leadership. So I wanted to close out our individual questions by drawing on Ariana to speak a little bit about leadership and a little bit about hope, just considering how important of a leader you are in your local community at your age. So I was just going to thank you for joining us and providing your perspective. I just wanted to ask, you know, how have you maintained hope through all the adversity that the last 18 months have thrown at us as a student, as a leader in your community, and as an advocate for your peers? And I guess really for you know, our purposes as mental health providers, how have institutions, namely schools and youth mental health services, best serve your community or youth community during this time? And how can we best reach the young people that are so uniquely affected by these challenges this year that we've all kind of touched on already?
Well, thank you for having me. So I feel like I personally have maintained hope from the past 2 years with like all the adversity that's been thrown at me, is that I understand that the people around me and my friends and peers are all experiencing the same things I'm experiencing. I have many friends that I'm very grateful that I'm able to reach out to when something is not okay or if I'm not feeling well. And I'm really grateful that I also have friends that share the same experiences as me and can have conversations surrounding mental health. And when someone you can just talk to when something's not going well, you can just have someone to reach out to. Speaking of like mental health, I'm also very grateful that I can have conversations with my own peers surrounding mental health. I feel like there's a stigma surrounding mental health, so being able to talk about it in just a casual setting with friends is something very comforting and comfortable. Like, for example, I could be like, oh, do you want to hang out this weekend? Or it's like, no, I feel like I need to take a break. I need to take some time for myself. Or no, I'm going to be seeing my therapist this weekend. And we can have these conversations and not feel uncomfortable about it, because we're all going through the same experiences after having the pandemic and remote learning and hybrid learning. We're all experiencing the same things. So that's one of the first things I'm very grateful for. So I've also been learning to give myself breaks when I need to. As a senior in high school, I feel like I'm constantly swamped with work. I find it very funny that like teachers throughout high school would tell us that junior year is the most stressful year, but I spent my junior year online doing remote learning, and half the time I was in my pajamas attending class. So I feel that senior year was probably the most stressful, trying to manage work, and some people have jobs, and then managing clubs and especially college applications, which are so stressful. So I've been learning to give myself breaks, because I'm not the Energizer Bunny and I just can't keep going and going and going. So I've been learning to give myself breaks and give myself time to just breathe. So to do that, I've been doing a lot of connecting with nature. So as I mentioned before, I'm very passionate about the environment and climate change. And when the weather was much warmer than it is right now, I would go on hikes with my friends every weekend, with my family, and just connecting with nature, I feel like, is so calming and just like a nice thing that you can get away from all the adversity that's in your present life. Also, I've been doing a lot of yoga and meditation every night. I've been trying to just be able to breathe and calm down and just absorb everything that I've experienced throughout the day and just be like, this happened. Maybe something good didn't happen. Maybe something good did happen. Let me just process all the information that I've experienced today and just breathe, just be calm. I've also been getting into journaling. I feel like sometimes some things are just harder to say in person, even if I have friends like mine, which is easy to talk to. So I can write anything that I'm feeling down in my journal. If I don't really understand why I'm feeling a certain way, I can simply write it down in my journal. And it's like, oh, okay, now that this is happening, I can figure out how I'm going to better understand myself and hopefully maybe prevent this thing from happening again. And just really just trying to understand myself and what I'm going through personally. And for like institutions, personally, I'm very, very grateful that my school is pretty pretty affluent. There's a lot of resources that they provide for us. At my school, they give us opportunities to start our own clubs. And my two friends, actually, my friend Kara and my friend Camilla, have started a club called the Mindful Mounties. So our mascot is the Mounties, the mountain lion. So we have the Mindful Mounties, and it's basically a self-care club that they started that's open for all students at the school, freshmen to seniors. And it's basically just a club where they all come together, talk, and just do things like self-care. They journal, they meditate, they really just talk to each other. And I love that it creates a safe space for students to really understand what everyone else is going through. And it just creates a safe space where they're able to talk and understand each other and really just understand each other's emotions and figure out their own emotions if they're confused about that. what else would I like to mention? I'm also very grateful that my school provides a lot of resources. At my school specifically, we have a lot of psychologists at hand that students can talk to if something's not right. We have social workers at my school that students can talk to if they don't feel safe at home. And even my own teachers, even though some of them joke how much like, oh, these students aren't my favorite students, even though we know they're joking, they're just a little sarcastic, but we're very comfortable with our teachers and we know that if something's not right, we can always speak to our teachers and they're always open to talk to us. My school also provides a lot of assemblies. About actually 2 weeks ago, we had an assembly. I wish I could remember the name. I'm really blanking right now. But a man came to talk about his best friend who died by suicide because he was struggling with OCD. And the man also struggled with OCD. So he was telling us about his experience with OCD and that there are resources that we as students can go to and we can talk to him and talk to others about any mental health problems that we were having. And we just have many other assemblies surrounding mental health and just understanding our own emotions and talking to other people and just having open conversations about things that have a stigma towards them. So overall, I feel like if a school can provide these aspects and organizations and things to students, that's very important to really get students connected. But even if they have all the resources to give these experiences to students, there needs to be a way to spread the word to students. So I feel like word of mouth is very important, telling your friends about things, having announcements to students like, hey, there's this club. If you're really interested, you can join it. Or sending out flyers like, oh, there's an assembly today. If you can join us and just listen and maybe help us understand what you're going through and stuff like that. And yeah, just having a way to get the word out and spread it to people. I would also say social media. I feel like social media can be very beneficial to spread the word to students and especially young people, as I feel like the majority of us is on social media, and there are its downsides to social media, I will admit. But I feel like social media is very fast and it's very easy to spread information to students. So that's why I feel like a lot of clubs at my school, specifically like the Mindful Mounties, they can make these Instagram accounts or Facebook accounts and really spread the word to a larger group of people instead of just our own school. So really just spreading the word, getting people out there, letting students know that there are resources for them, because many people don't know. Like many, even though I know about all these things because my friends are in them or people tell me about them, I'm not everyone and not everyone knows that these resources are available for them. So just getting the word out that it's there and the option is there, that if you need it, it's there for you, so you feel less alone. And so students around us can feel less alone and more comfortable in the space that they're in. And yeah.
Thank you so much, Ariana, for rounding out our individual questions. That was a great perspective and a great way to ground our conversation around youth populations and some really positive outcomes that we can look forward to. We don't have that much time left, but I do want to just give time for one more question that I'm going to go around and ask everybody, give everybody about a minute. Surrounding one of the big through lines of our conversation thus far, and that's been around hope. It's been around, I've certainly, as I'm sure our audience has, gained a lot of hope for our future, just hearing the perspectives from your work and your experiences. But just kind of diving into how we can provide hope and leaving us with one little nugget of how we can inspire hope in all the communities around us, particularly in the youth populations we work with. I just wanted to read a little bit of a background on hope and then just ask one little closing question. I'm gonna give each of you about a minute for it. So, researchers were concerned about the number of children experiencing adverse childhood experiences and post-traumatic stress disorder before the pandemic. This is something we talked about at length. And given how our world has changed since 2020 with ongoing racial injustice and the ever-increasing urgency brought on by climate change, Dr. Duncan Andrade said in an interview that hope is the best indicator for the degree to which kids will successfully navigate toxic stress and the degree to which kids are less likely to engage in self-harming behavior. But he warns that hope cannot be false hope, like the one that promises, if you work hard, you'll be successful. And there's so many factors in our society that are barriers to success and that do cause harm. We need to acknowledge these factors, and that's why Dr. Duncan Andre talks about critical hope in particular as being an essential notion when engaging with young people. So just following the same order that we went through the previous round of questions, I just want to ask, what are you doing today and tomorrow to nurture and instill critical hope in the young people you work with? How, from your perspective, can our audience walk away from this conversation and contribute building communities that center the well-being, or that are centered particularly in the well-being of children and young people. And Dr. Balchan, I'll start off with you again.
Thank you. I just want to say, you know, hearing everybody speak is, it's just been phenomenally inspirational. I know I didn't give much of a personal experience, but I think that having that personal experience and being your authentic self and acknowledging that, you know, if I was a high school student in the midst of this pandemic, I would have probably been a statistic. My school was my safe haven, and thankfully there were groups that focused on kids that needed support. There were, you know, involvement with the arts and with outside sports that, you know, gave an outlet and a sense of community and connection and togetherness. And I think that over time, we know that having that connectedness to other people and having somebody that really takes an interest in you is going to make such a tremendous difference. And leaning on those individuals and being that person for our youth and for our peers and for the families that we work with to kind of be an emotional container for whatever they're dealing with at the moment, having that validation and acknowledgement that, you know, you hear them, you may not have the answer for them, but then we can also screen and make sure that anybody in significant crisis, obviously, you know, we have to make referrals to child and family services, or we have to make sure that somebody that's suicidal gets emergency care. But overall, there are basic human tendencies for us to affiliate and to connect. And so it's not only always the fight or flight response to stress and trauma. We have to acknowledge that there's actually an oxytocin mediated response of affiliation that can divert us from having those stress reactions that are immobilizing or that cause the violence. And so if our youth are looking to us and they see safety incoming to us, then we may not get to the root of the problem right there, but they'll be able to come back because they know that they have somebody that's got their back. And so that throughout my life, I can look back through critical low points that I had somebody that was digging me up out of that hole that I knew no matter what, I couldn't go to my parents, but I could go to them and that they were going to get me to that next level. And that's how I was able to become successful. And that's what drove me into this type of work. And so as professionals, we can be re-traumatized. So I also encourage anybody that's feeling overwhelmed to, you know, really consider if they needed a break. And taking that professional break, you should be amongst peers that support you in that so that you can recharge and refresh and come back, whether it's a day, a week, or a couple of months. And so in order to continue this work, we have to be self-aware and we need to be vulnerable and be willing to share those vulnerabilities so that we can show that post-traumatic growth and we can be an inspiration to others. Looking forward to hearing from the rest of you.
Thank you so much. Carl, you have about a minute.
I'd say my wife's a pessimist and I'm an optimist. She thinks the house is going to burn down, and I agree it's going to burn down, but I think we'll get out just in time. And I think the most healing thing is trying to change the world. And there's a story about Custer Little Bighorn. A scout comes and says there's good news and bad news. And he says, give me the good news first. And he says, General, you can attack in any direction. And when you try to change the world, you have that as good news. There's so many things screwed up, so many ways people are suffering, so many things that don't make sense, that if you keep trying and work with other people, you're going to find ways to make the world better. And that the question isn't whether you're going to succeed. The question is only how much and how soon.
Thank you so much. And Audi?
I just, you know, to piggyback off of what we've all been saying, building community where we all get to not just encourage, but support both children and young people to be their authentic selves, to be who they are, to allow them the space to use their voice, to explore their voice, their needs, And also with that said, supporting the adults that are supporting the children, the young people. So it is so important that we not forget how crucial it is that the adults who are the ones who are with our children and our young people every single day get the support that they need on a daily basis to make sure that they're encouraging, that their mental health needs are being taken care of, that they understand the importance of inclusion, the importance of, you know, equity, the importance of all of the things that we've been talking about. Because we can't build communities with healthy young people if we don't have communities with healthy adults, because they are the ones who are really doing the work. So we have to figure out how to support each other, how to have the right resources for each other. And sometimes that just means being kind to each other. Sometimes it's being kind to ourselves and allowing ourselves a little bit of grace when we mess up and when we make mistakes and when we don't know everything, because we don't. And being graceful for others in their learning process as well.
That is all so, so true and so important. Thank you so much. Jessica, you have about a minute.
Yeah, it's bouncing off of Inaudi's points, kindness is our greatest organizational asset and also the most difficult to achieve, because there is no contract out there to get kindness in your organization. It comes down to your capacity to love and really just reimagine what does love look like in the work that you do. Oftentimes our training and our education teaches us the importance of boundaries, but we incorporate those boundaries so much so that we create a disconnection and a wall between the people that need love and connection so much. So I really would just like to close with a quote from the wonderful Amanda Gorman, the young poet who spoke at the Biden-Harris inauguration, for there is always light if we are brave enough to see it, if only we are brave enough to be it.
Awesome, thank you so much. Ariana?
So from my perspective as a young person, I feel like the audience can contribute to building communities that center the well-being of children and other young people by making children feel comfortable. I feel like some conversations surrounding mental health are really hard for some students and people and young people to talk about. So creating a sense of comfort of a community that's comforting and comfortable for a student to talk about, it will be so much easier for another student to really explain to an adult what they're feeling and how an adult can actually help them. And just creating a community where a student feels safe and can really express their emotions in a safe environment.
Thank you so much. That's such an important point to wrap up on. And I just want to reiterate again my thanks for all of you for joining us, and just reiterate how every point that's been made has been so important in my life and my work, even just as a student. These are all really important ways to preserve hope, to maintain hope, and to find real success in spite of some profound challenges that we've faced together. But we'll come through together and come out stronger together, moving out of 2020 and out of 2021. So I don't know if we have time for a question from the audience, but I'm going to hand the floor back to Yulika to wrap up this presentation, this panel discussion, and present any questions that we might have time for.
Yes, thank you so much. There's one question in the Q&A, and so maybe we have a chance to answer too. So if anyone else would like to add a question, now's your time. But the question here is, what are your thoughts about what an ideal youth therapeutic residence would look like, if one is possible at all?
Sure, so I can just open that up. If any of the panelists have a perspective that they'd like to contribute, first person to jump on it is welcome to go ahead. Can read out the question again. It was, what are your thoughts about what an ideal therapeutic residence would look like, if one is possible at all?
I don't know what an ideal one would look like, but I would encourage that panel and that committee of people putting it together would be at least half young people to make sure that their voice is heard with what's ideal for their needs.
And it should include a social change component with the Bravehearts as a support for the residents and as an opportunity for the residents to change the world as part of their own healing process.
And if I could add to that, it would be staffed by credible messengers and young professionals with lived experience.
Great. And then it looks like another question just popped up in the chat, just our last one for the morning, and I'll direct this for Dr. Balchan. How can we personalize Western medicine more and take a little bit more of an extra touch in meeting productivity?
Thanks. That's a great question. How can we approach Western medicine differently? I think there, administratively, from the top down, there are factors that really influence how people are able to practice medicine. I think those that strive to practice in a different format and increase their awareness are gravitating into that field right now. I think that the American Academy of Pediatrics is moving towards training more of the providers in trauma-informed care, but it is a niche. You know, and people that work in foster care, people that work in school health from the medical standpoint, you know, and I'm just speaking from the youth treating providers, not necessarily adult medicine. We have to look at systems and have voices heard. You know, I think it's a big step to have national organizations and the Surgeon General really prioritize resilience over the adversities, you know, focusing on the strengths and building that together, but carving out time. And it's the payer system. Many of our organizations are financially driven, and that unfortunately becomes the reason why people either burn out or leave the profession or are unable to connect as much as they want to. When I was running the foster care clinic that, you know, I was in for over 5 years, I would have a lot of time to be with those youth, and youth show up whenever they want to show up, and you are just available for them. In a regular private practice, that is nearly impossible. You know, Jessica was talking about the barriers to telemedicine and just navigating. Traumas will in itself is its own barrier. And if you have encountered something within medicine that has not been comforting or welcoming, you're less likely to re-engage. And so from the front office, from the first experience with the system, those steps need to really be evaluated and from a trauma-informed way. And so while we're dealing with all of the adults in our society grappling with this, it's gonna be a tremendous undertaking to promote that philosophy throughout. But I'm hopeful, I'm an eternal optimist. I keep on rising from the ashes and trying to bring that enthusiasm to the groups and the organizations that I'm able to work with. And so hopefully with a united front, we'll be able to forge that into the future for our kids and future generations.
Awesome, thank you so much. I believe this almost wraps it up. So I'm just gonna hand it off to you, Luca, again to close things off.
One last note, if I may, since I had the stage for a moment, I wanna just be a messenger of truth regarding the COVID vaccination for children and its safety and efficacy. And so as we're working with our families and youth, trying to provide them with that level of support and inquire as to whether or not they or their families have been vaccinated, have been boosted, so that they can have that level of safety that can prevent significant risks of hospitalization, severe illness, and death from COVID. That's part of getting out of this mess as well.
Thank you so much. Well, I scared my dog a couple of times because I was clapping or screaming or saying yes so loud here behind the screen. And I really am so very grateful to all of you for joining us today and taking us really so deep in such a short time. And of course, there's so much more to do, but as Carl said, we can go in all directions. We're not short of things to do. And I really appreciate all of what you brought here. And Henri, thank you so much for your wonderful facilitation. Really, I mean, It couldn't have been better. So we really, really appreciate this. Before you all go or log off, we would love you to click that link in the chat to a survey that can allow you to give some feedback on today's session. And then, of course, I want to remind you of this afternoon sessions. You should have received the links to log in. And then also look out for information for a program that we will be continuing next year with our monthly webinar series on growing resilience, where we will tackle different issues related to that. We have a fantastic lineup of speakers, including Dr. Ken Ginsberg. So make sure you check that out and you join us for that. And with that, I hope to see you this afternoon, or some of you, and the recordings will be available in the next couple of days, and everyone will receive them all via email. So with that, really, thank you so very much, and keep doing the wonderful work. Thank you all for joining us. It's been delightful.